Thank you very much. Good morning. I would also like to thank the organizers and thank all of you. So, okay, just a minute. Okay, as you probably know, and you can see here in a recent European report, depression is twice more common in women than in men. And as you can see here, and also other stress-related disorders like PTSD or panic disorder are more common in women than in men. And although the representation of women has increased in clinical trials, especially for depression, there are still conflicting human data. There is still a lot of research to be done on sex-oriented treatments. What we know so far is that probably men respond better to the classical antidepressants like imipramine, while women respond better to newer antidepressants, the second generation, not new anymore, like sertraline SSRIs, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. And this was confirmed also by a large study that you might have heard about, STAR-D. It was a multi-center, a very big study, and it was shown that women have a better response to the SSRI citalopram than men. Also, there are sex differences in the pharmacokinetics of antidepressants. We have also written a review recently about this. And it seems that women are exposed to higher levels of antidepressants than men. So we need more research about depression, both clinical research but also basic research. And we need to include more females in our studies. You might be aware of this study that was published in 2011, showing that although in human studies the inclusion of women is relatively okay. You can see in neuroscience both women and men in purple and in pharmacology. So there is a good percentage of women. But in animal studies, still in neuroscience and in pharmacology, most people usually use male animals. And this is especially problematic for disorders like depression, that they are more common in women than in men. So you can imagine that we cannot study something that is more frequent in women and not include female animals. So in our lab, we are trying to do something about it. But also in other labs, there is a lot of research. You will also hear some very interesting talks after me and tomorrow also. This afternoon, we have used mainly the chronic mild stress model of depression and the four swim test, that I will show you most of the data on this. We have also used the Flinders-sensitive Lyrat genetic model in the lab in Athens, and in the lab that I was in New Jersey at Rutgers, we also used the learned helplessness model. There are many more, and some of them I don't even have them here. What I can tell you from now is that in all models of depression, there are sex differences. And there are sex differences both in the behavior, but also in the neurobiology that we study. And this depends many times on the parameters that we choose to study. And as you can see here, and I hope you will see also from the data, there are sex differences in the basal levels between males and females. And what do we mean when we say basal levels? We mean without any stress exposure or without any manipulation, with no treatment, there are differences between males and females that we need to identify and begin with that. And many times when we treat with antidepressants, these sex differences are eliminated. We mask sex differences, and this is something that we believe that it also happens in humans. So in the study about learned helplessness that we did with Professor Sors at Rutgers, we showed that females do not express learned helplessness as males do in a subtle box. I'm not going into details about this. In Athens, we have used a lot the chronic mild stress model. It's a chronic model that it consists of unpredictable mild stressors. It lasts for at least 6 weeks. It's something very long, and it's a valid model of depression. We have found effects, sex difference in the serotonergic activity, the dopaminergic activity. I don't want to tell you all the details about this now, but on a behavioral level, we found that it decreases sucrose intake in both males and females. Sucrose intake is a behavioral index that it's supposed to simulate anhedonia, the loss of pleasure, that it's a core symptom of depression. So when the rats become depressed in a way, we have the depressive phenotype, there is a decrease in the sucrose solution, the amount of sucrose that they drink. As you can see here, the decrease is not so good in females, and we believe that this is an index, a behavioral index, that it's more difficult to replicate in females than in male rats. Also, some years ago with this paradigm, we had found that the corticosterone levels after 6 weeks of stress were enhanced only in female rats and not in males. Also, serotonergic activity, as this is measured by the ratio of 5-HIA. 5-HIA is the metabolite of serotonin to serotonin. It's the tissue levels in the hippocampus. It was decreased only in females. Also, what was interesting in this study was that also the estrous cycle was disrupted in female rats that they were stressed for so long. So we are continuing to do chronic mild stress in our lab, and I hope that next time I'll show you some more new exciting data. But now I want to focus more on the four-swim test. It's a much shorter paradigm of 2 days. This is what we record in the lab. We put the rat in the cylinder to swim. It's a stressful procedure for the rat. We record climbing, which is this active behavior that you can see here. Also, floating or immobility, you will see that as immobility later. This is the depressive behavior in a way. It's supposed to be an index of despair. This is the behavior that it's decreased by antidepressant treatment, as you will see later. And in between, rats are swimming. We can score all these behaviors. Swimming, it's enhanced by a serotonergic antidepressants, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, as you will see later. And we score these behaviors. We are using a newly developed program that we have made in our lab, and it's called Kinoscope. It's a free program if someone wants to use it for manual scoring of behavior. And it's very convenient because we can store all our behavioral data on a local database. And I need to thank Dimitris Baltas for this. By using the four-swim test as a stressful procedure of 2 days, 15 days of swim, and then 15 minutes of swim stress, and then the next day 5 minutes of swim stress. We have found also differences in the serotonergic and dopaminergic activity in between males and females, and also sex difference in the antidepressant response in the Flinders sensitive line rat. Unfortunately, I don't have time to show you all this data, but I would like to show you some behavioral data with the four swim. This was from a recent study that Nikos Kokras did and we published. We have found many times that females have higher immobility levels than males in the four-swim test. This is the depressive behavior. And here we have grouped them in according to the estrous cycle. I'll give you more details on that at the next slide. But you can see that females show more depressive behavior, more immobility than males. And we wanted to see if this is related to the enhanced corticosterone levels, the enhanced HPA axis activity that female rats have in comparison to males. This is something that is very consistent in the literature, that females have higher corticosterone levels. So to see that, we did adrenalectomy and the replacement with corticosterone. We eliminated the sex difference here. You can see there is no difference in corticosterone levels anymore. But in behavior, still there is the sex difference. Females have higher immobility levels than males, higher depressive behavior. So we concluded that it's not related. And we continue this study with antidepressant treatment with citalopram. And we hope we'll have interesting data on that. So, but with the force test, I show you some with the estrous cycle, but we wanted to see in a much more detailed study what's the effect of the estrous cycle. You know that rats have 4 days estrous cycle with the fluctuation of estrogen and progesterone, and people keep asking us at which phase of the estrous cycle should I use my females, and we always had this question in our lab. So we did a study with adult male and female rats. We used the Pharmacology, the standard protocol that it has been, the modified that has been developed by Professor Lackey's lab. And we used the standard treatment with reinjections of sertraline, it's an SSRI. And we did all the combinations of the estrous cycle, so it was much more detailed than before, and in comparison to males, of course. And we found that sertraline, of course, was effective to decrease immobility levels in males and also in all phases of the cycle, and to increase swimming. This is something that it was expected because sertraline increase enhances serotonergic activity. What was strange here is that we don't find an effect when females are in the transition from the diestrous to proestrous. So this is the phases where there is a peak in estrogen. And this is interesting because before in the lab of Tracy Source, and we have all done many studies on this, we have found that females are more vulnerable to stress when in this transition from diestrous to proestrous. So maybe the antidepressant effect is not so much evident there. And we see that the sex hormones should play a role in the behavioral effect in the four-swim test. And we also saw that by correlating the uterus weight, that it's indicative of estrogen levels with swimming behavior. You can see here in vehicle-treated rats that there is a positive correlation. But what's interesting is that this correlation does not exist anymore when we treat the rats with sertraline. So in a way, the correlation between estrogen and swimming and behavior is masked after treatment. But we still have the correlation in the brain. We know that in the prefrontal cortex, serotonergic activity, you can see here 5-HT level serotonin, and also the ratio of the 5-HIA, the metabolite of serotonin, to serotonin. They are correlated with swimming, especially in the prefrontal cortex. So in the last study that I want to show you, that we are very excited about it, we took advantage of what we know, that the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus are very much involved in this behavioral response in the force swim test. And we did a lesion in order to disrupt the circuit of the hippocampus prefrontal cortex. And it is known from the literature that hippocampus is directly connected to the prefrontal cortex, but the reverse connection relies mainly on a relay thalamus nucleus, the nucleus reunions that you can, it's there in the thalamus. This was a study that it was done by a very talented PhD student, Vasilis Kafetzopoulos, that I'm very lucky to have in the lab. He managed to do the lesion of this very small nucleus here. It's an NMDA excitotoxic lesion in both males and female rats. And we did, again, the force swim test in the same way. We gave the antidepressant, sertraline. This time we took advantage of what we knew about the estrous cycle, and we chose our rats to be in diestrous phases where estrogen levels are low, so we could have the antidepressant effect much more evident and compare them with males. And what we found? We found the sex difference in immobility levels again. When we lesioned the circuit of the prefrontal cortex to the hippocampus, there was a decrease in the depressive behavior in immobility levels in both males and females. So in a way, when the circuit is disrupted, we cannot really have the same behavioral response to stress, and probably the depressive behavior is not so much evident. And when we treated with antidepressant, with sertraline, in some operated rats, some operators are the control rats with no really any lesion, we found the effect of sertraline to decrease immobility. What is interesting here is you can see that the sex difference is in immobility level is no longer there. It's masked by the treatment. So these two bars are the same in comparison to two of these. And then in the lesion rats, we had no effect in males. Probably there was also a floor effect. But in females, there was even a higher decrease of immobility level. So we can see the sex-differentiated response, and that it depends also on sex difference in basal levels. So to conclude, I hope that I convinced you, and the next speakers also will convince you that depression and stress studies should be sex-aware. We need careful validation of our models. We need to keep this in mind. We need optimal behavioral indices for both males and females. I hope I helped you with our data on chronic mild stress and for swim that we can use appropriately for female rats as well. And my advice would be to use females in the for swim at the diestrous phases, so it's easier to compare them with males and see the antidepressant response. And as far as treatment is concerned, again, we need to have sensitive behavioral indices for both males and females. Sometimes also from other studies from our lab and other people, we know that we need to have different behavioral indices for males and females. Sometimes we need to use the immobility latency instead of just the immobility duration in the four-swim test. And also to keep in mind that there are sex differences in baseline that they can change the response to the drug. And these sex differences sometimes are masked by the antidepressant treatment. And this is something that maybe be also relevant to humans. So I would like to thank you very much for listening and coming so early. I would like to thank our funding sources, and there are not very many in Greece. Thank our collaborators in Greece and in Europe. Professor Daifoti, that she has recently retired from our lab, and all our students and the members of our lab, and especially I would like to thank Dr. Nikos Kokras, that he's a psychiatrist of our team, but he's also an excellent researcher. And I'll finish with a picture of the women of the lab and two men of the lab. Thank you very much.
So there's time for questions, and I'll walk the mic to you so we can actually hear your question.
So, fantastic talk. When I talk to people about sex differences, I often get the impression that they're afraid of using females because they feel that they have to take estrocycle into account. How do you feel about that sort of aversion to females for that reason? Do you think that there is any use in just doing females without looking at cycling at all?
Yes, of course. Our first studies and most people's first studies are without taking account of the estrous cycle. First, we need to do a study just to compare males and females to see if there is any difference. And then we can go into detail and see the effect of the estrous cycle and Then we can go into further detail and see organizational and activational effects of hormones. But at the beginning, we need to see the behavior in just normal rats. Maybe you need more than six per group to see also if there is a big variation in depression in behavior. But certainly you can start with... and we shouldn't be afraid of using females. I know it's difficult, but... It's very important.
Christina, how do you explain the chronic mild stress difference? So the fact that the females are not that responsive to the stressor, when, as you say, in the human population, it seems to be that the females are more responsive.
Yes, that's on a behavioral level for the sucrose test. Because in other behavioral, like the open field test or, I think also the plus mass, we haven't done it, but other people have done it, females do respond. It's only the sucrose test that they don't have a very good response. And I think it's because of sex differences in the basal levels and how females drink. Maybe they drink more sucrose or they don't have such a good, the controls are not so stable. So it's not that they don't respond to the stressor, it's just that we don't have a very good behavioral output to see that. Because corticosterone levels are enhanced, the estrous cycle is disrupted, we know that these rats are affected by stress. The body weight is, there is a decrease in the ratio of body weight gain. So it's the behavioral index that we need something better.
And are they cycling at the same time? By the end of the experiment, are they all cycling together, or is it just could it be a variability issue with the sucrose, depending on where they are in the estrous cycle?
By the end of the experiment, most of them they do not cycle at all.
Okay,
that's the problem.
Yeah, yeah.
Not problem. I mean, it's the stress effect probably. It's more than probably 70% that they don't cycle. So they don't really synchronize or. And they are only single house, so this also may be a confounding factor in females, because female rats do not like to be single housed.
Thank you. Hi there, very nice talk. I have a question about the HPA axis, because I just revised a bunch of literature on HPA axis between humans and rats, and it seems like rats have the increased stress response. But then in humans, you don't really see that. That's kind of a key difference. How do you explain that, and can you maybe elaborate on that?
Yes, actually, there are many differences between humans and rats, and also even between rats and mice and other species. I think it's more complicated in humans because sometimes even in depression, we don't have an increased cortisol response, and there is even sometimes decreased response of the HPA axis. So it's more variable in humans. There are many different syndromes, and probably the HPA axis response is also involved in different subtypes of depression. So I think we cannot really extrapolate this data in humans, but it's interesting to see it in comparison to the behavior and also the stress response.
Any other questions?
I just would like to introduce now Deborah Mangasser. She's an assistant professor at Temple University, and she will talk about sex differences in stress-related psychiatric disease, novel mechanisms for interactions between stress and arousal systems.